Hello everybody, welcome back to Exotic Astrology. And today, after many requests for the eclipse which is happening on 11th August in the Nakshatra of Ashlesha, we are back with Anuradha ji with Ashlesha Nakshatra today. So let us explore what is there in this Nakshatra, and we have also done many other videos on Nakshatras which is there in this playlist itself. So if you have not watched them, please go and watch it. We did Swati, Pushya and so many other nakshatras, and we will also be doing in future. And she also has a YouTube channel. There's amazing content there. Please go and subscribe to it. And she also does consultations. I will post the link of her channel and the website in the description below. And she also has some announcements to make. So welcome to Exotic Astrology. Please share about Ashlesha with us.
Thank you so much, Bhavajit. This channel gives me a lot of pleasure to be here, getting a lot of good reviews from people from this channel. So it's a pleasure to be here with all of you. I have a course on Prashna coming up from 4th of August. So if there's anybody who wants to learn Prashna, you're more than welcome to that course. So now let's talk about Ashlesha. Ashlesha is the last of the first nine nakshatras. Mercury nakshatras take up the last nakshatra of the set of the nine nakshatras, three sets. So the three sets are, of the three sets are Ashlesha, Jyeshtha and Revati. Of these three, Ashlesha and Jyeshtha have a lot of issues as compared to the Revati nakshatra. Revati is much more of a benefic than Ashlesha and Jyeshtha. The powers that Ashlesha has is also phenomenal, but the amount of hard work, the hardships that people having planets in this nakshatra have is equally phenomenal. Ashlesha, Jyeshtha and Revati are also on the Gandhanta. That means they're on the edge where one set ends and the other set begins. One set of nakshatras that is from Ashwini to Ashlesha, that is from Ketu to that of Mercury. It's a set ending and set beginning again of Ketu from Magha. Okay, so this is that point, you know, where is something very weak, where there is a, where you have to stitch it up. The cloth is where the weakest, where there is a stitch. And here is a stitch. So this is the Gandh Ant. There is a end of the knot. And it's a transition from a water sign to a fire sign. We know that water and fire don't mix. Now let's take it into an esoteric manner. Water is past. Fire is future. So your past has to be over before you move into the future. Right?
Okay.
You have to let go of your past. So this is the edge. Typically, I have a full session on Gandhanta with my students. I'm just introducing the topic here. Typically, at the edge, that is 48 minutes of the last degree of Cancer lies in the Gandhanta zone, and 48 minutes of the degree in the Aries sign, or be it, you know, Magha, or be it in the Mula, all the three signs of fire are the Gandhanta zones. So we have 48 degrees on either side, 48 minutes on either side, and that is where the karmic accumulation takes place for a sign. In fact, for the all nine signs, it comes and accumulates at that zone. Okay, and that is an area where planets find it a little too difficult to express themselves. As I have seen for Gandhanta here in, Cancer, there are generally issues with mother and motherland. We'll take it up as we go. Okay, so a lot of things come into forefront. Emotional upheaval a person undergoes, traumatized emotionally, lot of things you can take a look at. But before we go there, let's go into the basics of Ashlesha. So the Ashlesha Nakshatra is ruled by the deities called Naga. Okay, and the zonal area of the zodiac that they occupy is 16 degrees 40 minutes of Cancer to 30 degrees of Cancer. So it lies totally in the water sign of Cancer. The stars that it is occupying, you can see that these stars here in Cancer is Epsilon, Delta, Mu Hydra, Rho Hydra, Sigma Hydra, and Zeta Hydra. So these are the five stars that are visibly, visible from the Earth here. We can see with the telescope, and these are the most shiniest of the stars. When we say the five stars, you can see that there are a lot of tiny dots on either sides. But so that means that we are not supposed to say that these are the only stars that make the this sign of this nakshatra. There are millions of stars, but they just twinkle. We just see those twinkling stars, but then actually huge stars, much bigger than our Earth, but because of their distance from Earth, we are not able to see. These are the stars which are specifically visible, and they give a shape to the nakshatra that we are talking about. The shape here is that of the Nagas or a serpent. Okay, and they are defied serpents. They are the deities of wisdom and underworld, and are called Nagaloka. And these deities, as we will also be understanding, they have a very strong, power of hypnosis. Let's go and explore. What is the Shakti of this nakshatra? This Shakti of this nakshatra is Vish Ashleshna Shakti. So this is so much in tune with the snakes, the power to inflict poison and destroy the enemy. So when we say you inflict poison and you destroy the enemy, there's only one thing that comes to mind, and that is the snake.
Snake.
It's the approach of a serpent. Very quiet, very sleek, but they know where they're heading. And the foundation below is agitation or trembling. Inside of it, the snake is a very nervous animal. The snake is a very hypersensitive animal. And there's only one desire for the snake. It has to overcome its enemies. So the result is the destruction of the victim. So if you are on the radar of a Ashlesha person, not on the right side of the radar, in that case, you've had it. They know how to get back. And it's not that they do it, they don't. It's not like they will do it all the time. It's just when they are provoked, they are going to do it. Oh. Let's take, again, our favorite person. See, as I've always said, Not one planet or nakshatra can define a monumental event in your life. There should be many yogas. See, yogas can have many sides to it, positive, negative, and depending on where it is placed, the yoga can express itself in many a ways. And what does yoga mean? Yoga means the combination of two things. It can be a planet and a sign. It can be a planet and a nakshatra. It can be a house and a nakshatra. It can be a house and a planet and a nakshatra. So many combinations you can have. That is yoga. Yoga means a combination. So depending upon what is going to unfold in your life, or how something is, what is the result of something in your life, it is definitely can be seen from your chart. And if it is of a huge magnitude, getting rid of 30 million people on the planet in a matter of 13 years is no joke. So it has to show huge number of we did it when we were doing Ashwini also, the swiftness with which he killed people.
Yes.
with Sun, which is the Lord of the 11th house, sitting right there. Then he also had his Bharani. For Bharani, okay, that I had done it in my class. So he's got Nakshatra's planets in Bharani to be killing people. And then he's also having Saturn is in Ashlesha Nakshatra. Now let's see, how does this function out for him? Okay, if I take it to the Navamsh, which I can, but not, let's first see how it operates on the D1 chart. You see, Saturn is the lord of the fourth house of motherland and fifth house of power and authority. And it's posited in the 10th house of, again, profession, power and authority. And it's definitely aspecting its own house of the fourth house. So there it strengthens the fourth house. At the same time, one of its aspect is to the third house. What is the third house? Third from itself. That's the 12th house of exists. Okay? So when the 12th house of exists, it gives exits to people. And he was very definite in his views, whom he wanted to target, to remove people, to have an Aryan race.
Yes.
Fifth house is also lineage. So he was fifth lord going into the 10th house. So it was very, very clear in his mind. And he did it. Can you look into his eyes? Can you see the eyes? So definite, absolute vacuum, like a snake's eyes. Hypnotical and vacuum. You can read nothing from his eyes except a vacuum. Take up any picture of his. And there's a lot of determination you can read from his eyes.
Yeah, sometimes for all, people, they say, yes? Sometimes I meet people here because I am in Germany. They say, yes, that, oh, when he used to speak, it's like, that's it. Everybody will be like, yes, yes, he's right.
Yes, so it's hypnotic and it's determined, and he is and it's because I was always fascinated by the chart, because I wanted to know why was it and how was it that he could do something on such a scale.
Yes,
that you can't even dream of. And everything was so organized, so very organized. How was it possible? So it's like seventh house is also the house of known enemies. And Saturn from this point of Cancer also aspects by its 10th aspect on the seventh house of known enemies. So he knew who his enemies were. Again, he thought, if you take the seventh aspect of Saturn, which fell on the fourth house, he knew who the enemies of his motherland were. Or so he thought. Okay, so now let us move to the deities, the Nagas. So the Nagas or the Sarpas are defied serpents. They're the deities of wisdom. Deities presiding the underworld, also called Naga Lok. So there is a loka beneath the earth. They're said to be seven lokas above the earth, seven lokas below the earth. Though we are not able to find it, probably it's an esoteric or it's on a different plane. But then that's the way it is said in the Puranas. And one of them is inhabited by the Nagas. And I'll take you back to a story where Bhima in Mahabharata went to that loka because he was drowned by his cousins, poisoned and drowned by his cousin. And as he got, because he was, it takes a snake, antidote of a snake to take out a poison from, yes, your body. So the snakes came in and they started biting him. And because of that, it acted, their poison acted, their venom acted as an antidote. And he woke up. Okay, his body lost the venom and he woke up and he was very strong and he went about killing the snakes. So one of the Nagas came, the head of the Nagas came and stopped him and said that now I'm going to give you the, you know, the strength of 10,000 elephants. And he drank the liquid which contained that strength, and he drank 10 of it and he became as powerful as 10,000 elephants. So these Nagas have a very knowledgeable, and they're very wise. They know how to change shapes. So depending, what does that mean? Depending in today's day and time, you cannot say that the Ashlesha Nakshatra people can change shapes. You can say that depending on the situation, they will undergo a lot of changes. They will not stick to one thing. They will move. They have the ability to mold themselves according to the situations. Now, in one of the previous sessions, I did mention that there are 12 Adityas, right? Yes. I think when we were doing Ashwini.
In Swati.
When you do Swati. So each of the Adityas have an ability to be with different kind of Sarpas. That means the each of the Adityas, they have for their strings, reins of the chariot, a different form of Nagas or the Sarpas being pulled, being acting as the reins. Okay, it's a very esoteric thing. So, and these are the guardians of treasures. You know, the Naga people, the one thing very, very strong about them is they're very circumspect. They will not open their mouth unnecessarily. You tell them a secret, if this planet is not afflicted, if this nakshatra is not afflicted, you tell them a secret and it stays in their heart till they die, they go to the grave.
Okay, I see.
You have to learn to be interpretive in a different manner also, okay? But if it is afflicted, then these people are the first to gossip. See, if you take up old movies, I don't know about the Western movies, but if you take up the old Indian movies where there is a treasure to be hunted, the first thing a person comes across is a snake. And in Hindi, we say kundli maar ke baitha. That means he's guarding that treasure, and they have the innate wisdom to let it on only to those people who are truly worthy of it.
Okay.
So let's move on to a story. I think people here generally are fascinated by stories, my stories. So I'll move on to a story and then take up examples. Kadru and her children, the number of stories here, Kadru and her children, and these stories are described in detail. We take up two classes, three sometimes of 2.5 hours each, 2 hours each, so it's like 4 hours. So here I'm not able to contain all the stories. In my classes, we move all to all the stories. So today I'll be taking up Kadru and her children, and then Vasuki and Garuda, and Yagna of Janmajaya.
Janmajaya.
Or probably.
Very famous character in the Srimad Bhagavatam. He was the one who is the son of Parikshit Maharaj, and he said that I will burn all the snakes.
Snakes, yes. So we'll do that. So Kadru and her children. So Vanita and Kadru, two children, they're two sisters. Okay, of the 60 daughters of Daksh Prajapati, there are 12 daughters who are married to Rishi Kashyap. Now, who is Rishi Kashyap? Rishi Kashyap is said to be the one who propagates all the beings on this planet and the three worlds. So, the demons, the Rakshasas, that is, the Asuras, the Devtas, and the Manavs, and the animals that you see all around, not the Manav, but the Manav were the genre of, was taken over by Daksh Prajapati. But the rest, you see the animal kingdom also finds its heritage in Kashyap Rishi, okay, and the daughters of Dakshputa Prajapati. So now these are the two children or two wives of Daksh Prajapati. They are we know Diti and Aditi. Okay, they are also daughters of Daksh Prajapati and married to Kashyap Rishi. Diti is the mother of the demons or the asuras, and Aditi is the mother of the the devatas. Okay, yeah. These two mothers we know about. Now there are two more mothers you need to know about: Vanita and Kadru. Now Kadru is the I'll just start base quickly with one more theme. They say they're sisters, so they should not be having rivalry. But that, and do you know that in the Puranas it has been categorically stated? I can tell you the name or one of these classical books, you know, which says that two sisters should not be married in the same family.
Oh.
And then here they married to the same man.
Uh-huh.
So the classical text says very, very categorically, no marriage of two sisters in the same family. Okay. But here they say, and so there is rivalry between them. The famous rivalry between the asuras and the devatas.
Uh-huh.
So obviously the mothers will take the side of their children or the sister's children or the sister, obviously their own children.
Yes.
So there then exists rivalry also between the sisters. The relationship has gone for a toss. Okay. Now we move on to Kadru and her children. Kadru is very, what happens is now it is the duty of the husband to satisfy all the needs, physical, emotional, mental, spiritual and financial, as per the shastras, all the five needs. Go and read the Bhagavad Puran, Lord Vishnu says so. So it is that duty to satisfy those needs of his wife. Maharshi Kashyap had huge amount of celestial powers, okay, and he used to do penance for thousands of years. We are not talking about thousands of years as of now, we are talking about an age which was Satyug. So he comes across a time when he has done a lot of penance, and the first lady of the house he meets is Kadru, is Vanita. So he says, Vanita, ask for a boon. So she says that I want two children, but both of them have to be par excellence. Meanwhile, Kadru has already had a boon of having thousands of children. Okay, so the two children of Vanita that turn up, one of them is, you know, the charioteer, Arun of sun god, charioteer of sun god. And the other one that is born at a much later date, Arun was born because he cursed his mother also, but that's a different story. We're not going there today. We'll take up the case of our Garud. And this is a beautiful interplay where you see that he was born much later to Vanita. In the meantime, Kadru is very, very jealous that her sister managed to get a boon for two very powerful children, whereas she has thousands of children who are snakes.
Okay.
So while Arun has been born, and Arun curses his mother because he's born without his limbs are not fully developed because of an act of hurry of his mother. So he moves into the sky and he prays to the sun god to let him be his charioteer. He takes up the position of a charioteer with sun god. And he says that you wait for the other egg to be fully ready to come out. Don't do it, whatever happens to me. So here again, Kadru and her children and Vanita are taking a bath. So this year, the celestial horse, Uchishrava, he's Indra's horse. Okay, he is in the garden and he's just roaming about and he's just grazing and he's having a nice time basically. So Kadru says that, look at that horse, it's all white but its tail is black. So the Venita says, no, he has a white tail. You mistake, Kadru says, I'm telling you it's black. So they have a dispute over that matter. And Kadru, she started it with a very deceptive frame of mind. She wanted Venita to fall in that trap. Venita, poor lady, fell into that trap. And what happened was a very sorry state, because then she says that tomorrow again we'll come and we'll check out. If it's not black, then I will become your slave. And if it's black, then you will become my slave. And the child that you've not had till now, who will now come out of the egg, will also become a slave to my children. So you, and just imagine a sister putting these kind of, such kind of, conditions, yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Such kind of conditions to her own sister, knowing that her sister is right and she's cheating on her sister. Okay, so you're understanding the frame of the mind here?
Yes.
And so the next day she calls all her sons and she says that, go and color all the black snakes. She just told them, go and move into the tail of Uchishrava in such a manner that the tail appears black. So the few of them who actually, like, you have the Sheshnag and you have Ananta and then you have Vasuki, they are all very, very upset. They said that, mother, that would be lying. But she says, I curse you. You will die. So she's come to a point where she's cursing her own children. Okay? So they so that those weak ones who were like, we don't want to be cursed, they run and they move into the tail of the horse, Uchishrava. And when Kadru and Vanita come for a bath from far away, they see the tail as
black.
So what happens in that case? This lady here is very, very happy, and Vanita is lost. Vanita is lost. Then she says, you and your son are now my and my son's slave. So you can see that, and that cause when Garud comes out of the snake, of this, what do you say, egg, he sees that there is a strong, is a very strong presence of a, his mother is subjugated to a lot of hardships, a lot of bad treatment, a lot of ill treatment by his own aunt, by her own sister. Then he calls his mother aside, takes her and he counsels her and he asks all the facts. He comes to know of the fact, and then he says, okay, mother. And she says that, you and me are both now slaves to these people. So he says, mother, I was not born into slavery. I will not be here as a slave, but definitely I will make sure that you and I are released from this falsehood, because you were taken as a slave on false grounds. Now what she does, now that is the story of Garuda and the Nagas. So the Kadru and her children. Okay, and how they get into Garuda, they get hold of these things. Now let us move into another story, which is Garuda and the Nagas. So when we see about Garuda and the Nagas, what Garuda did there was, once he came to his form and he was a very magnificent bird, you know. He had a human body and a bird-like body, human and a body of a bird and a human mixed. And he was, when he flapped his wings, it was as if it was the sun spreading his or her wings. Okay, the sun god spreading his wings. And it is also Then, because you remember that Vinita had asked for very beautiful, just two, but very beautiful children. So it's like, no, you don't need too many things to make yourself happy. Things which are of repute will do you good. Okay, that's, you can have an underlying text here also. But nevertheless, what he does, Garuda does, he starts taking these snakes to a, he has to bear them. He takes them next to the sun. Okay, then Kadru realizes that he's being nasty. His children will die under the heat of the sun. So she prays to the sun god, please help me. A lot of attempts are made, okay, but by Garuda, but the snakes do not relent. So one day Garuda goes to the snakes and says, what do I do for you to be able to give me my and my mother's freedom? So they say, get us the Amrit or the nectar. Okay, so Garuda goes and he is successful in his mission. But Indra says that if you are successful here, if you feed it to those people, they already have an evil tendency. So they will rain this earth and they'll kill everybody. So how can you do that? So he realizes that there's a lot of truth there. He says, okay, my job is to go and put it there. Okay, once it's in their hold, if you take it back, it doesn't matter. So the story becomes like Indra says, okay, you take it. And when he's taking it, Garuda goes to the snakes and he says that, okay, I have got it. So, but you know, the ritual of partaking this is that you need to first take a bath and you need to pure and cleanse yourself. So all of them go to cleanse themselves. Indra rushes in with his aids, takes that and goes away. Takes the kumbh, that is the vessel of Amrit, and he moves away. Okay, and Garuda has lived up to his promise to the snakes, to the Nagas, and to Indra also. So what is he doing? What is he doing here? Can you say what Garuda has done here? He has maintained both the sides. Okay, and one very beautiful thing you would be able to understand or see here is that the snakes have fallen trap. I'll let you into a very fascinating facts. While Garuda was getting that kumbh vessel, the vessel of the Amrit, he dropped few drops at 12 different places.
Okay.
So in India, when we have a kumbh mela every year, we have it at a different. What the time that is governed by the Kumbh Mela is the change of Parihara of Jupiter. When Jupiter is the, that zone, that 40 days, there's a Kumbh Mela somewhere. And it's in a different. So after 12 years, the Kumbh Mela comes to one same place. Okay. So that was about Kumbh. But we now, what inference can we draw from that? We can infer from this that they are very sensual. See, there's also a relationship through the mother here. They're very afraid of their mother. They're dominated by their mother. Their mother can have a very unbalanced sense of justice, can have issues about jealousy. These people can be very hypnotic and manipulative. You saw the snakes moved into the tail of Uchishrava and were able to color it black, make it appear black. They're highly intelligent species. They knew how to get out of every situation that Garuda put in front of them. But finally, Garuda had to relent and ask. Garuda is said to be one of the most powerful beings, like the Sheshnag. Garuda is one of the most powerful beings of this system.
He's direct vehicle of Lord Vishnu.
He could not get them around. Yes, he is the vehicle of Lord Vishnu. And he said, it is said that one feather of Garuda is enough to hold the entire universe.
Wow.
So that is the stature. But we are not talking about Garuda here. We are talking about the Nagas. So the Nagas did not allow that power of Garuda to overwhelm them. So these people are so strong mentally that they do not allow power or physical, mental, emotional, whatever power to overwhelm them.
Okay?
They are highly intelligent people, and they're very, but one thing they are prone to is gossip. And gossip is something that they need to stay away from.
Okay.
Especially if you have a planet in Gandhanta. Remember, those who are gossiping with a planet in Gandhanta, you've come here to let that go. Because when you move into the fire sign, the planets also in lifetimes transfer, you know, they move.
Yeah, evolve.
In your lifetime, depending on, excuse me?
Evolve, you can say, kind of.
Yes, evolve, yes. My connection, it seems, is a little, dicey today. So, they also evolve. And when they evolve, they move forward. Because they have to complete the journey and they have to reach Revati. And the final destination is Revati. Because you have to leave this planet, move on to a higher plane. Okay, so what they have done here is a very, these planets have had, so anyone having it in Gandhanta needs to know that things like jealousy, rivalry, gossip has to be dropped in this lifetime if you want the planet to evolve. Now let's take an example. Sensual, seductive, mystic and hypnotic eyes. So Madonna, but her son, which is the Lagna Lord of the house. See, it gave her a lot of wisdom, gave her a lot of fame and name, but she had as sex. And it sold 1.5 million copies in several days. It takes a lifetime.
Could you just say it again? Your voice got little cut about Madonna.
Okay, Madonna has a son which is the Lagna Lord placed in the 12th house of international fame. Okay, and these snakes, as I have already mentioned, are extremely sensual. So Madonna has a book named Sex right there, and that book sold 1.5 million copies in a matter of days. It takes lifetimes for people to send 1.5 of any book. And it took her only few days to do that. And she acclaimed the fame with that book also. She was known as the queen of pop. Okay? And she is, it's at Gandhanta point. You see 29 degree and 51 degree Cancer. And she's taken up mysticism, and she's taken up a lot of other things of the occult, because this is a very, very mystic and a very occult oriented nakshatra. Very, very mystic and an occult oriented nakshatra. One another thing with these people you will see is that eyes are hypnotic, and snakes do not have the same eye color. So these people also do not have the same eye color. They love to change their eye color. It can be wear lenses, different colored lenses and things like that. Disguise, secrecy, deception and manipulation. So we have Michael Jackson. Okay, and he is when he went out in public, Babaji, can we pause for a minute. I'll get a better connection.
Yeah.